Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Toronto Geometry Colloquium. This is a weekly web series all about geometry processing.
This colloquium aims at promoting young researchers and researchers from traditionally underrepresented communities. Every week, we'll have one opener talking about their cutting-edge research for 10 minutes, followed by a headliner giving a keynote presentation.
And this week, our opener, Yong Li, is going to talk about iHeartLA, compatible markdown for linear algebra. And our headliner, Professor Richard Zhang, is going to talk about from pyramidality to monotonicity, new decomposition and packing problems for fabrication and planning. So if you have any questions, please leave comments in the YouTube chat or our Discord channel. So first, it is my great pleasure to introduce our opener, Yong Li. He's a PhD student at George Mason University, supervised by Professor Yotam Gingo. And before that, he was a senior iOS developer at Baidu, where he worked on how to efficiently spread information within a dynamic network. But during his PhD, he switched his focus to programming languages and to develop tools that are going to change how we do research. For example, I spent a lot of time converting my equations from like the markdown into C++. And we need to make sure we are be careful about the data types or initialization. We also spend a lot of time converting our equations to LaTeX in order to write the papers. But luckily, Yang has developed a magical tool that can automatically convert equations we write in markdown into all sorts of different formats, like C++, Python, MATLAB, or LaTeX code. And I really think this is going to change our life and make our life easier without the need of bothering with mathematical bugs. So without further ado, please join me to welcome Yong Li. Oh, by the way, due to the connection issues, Yong will be giving his talk with his video off, but he's here with us. Please take away, Yong.
Yeah, thanks, Derek, for the introduction. Yeah, due to the connection issues, I will tap my video and let me share my screen. And the slide, is it good now?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Hello, and welcome to my talk. My name is Yong Li, and I'm a PhD student in George Mason University. We create a new programming language called iHeartLA, which is a compilable markdown for linear algebra. LA is short for linear algebra here. As PhD students, we often need to evaluate a paper. We read the paper over and find the formula. For this example, we may first implement it by C++. During implementation, it's easy to create bugs that we may never notice. Later on, we may switch it to Python and need to re-implement the same formula. In general, it's inconvenient to maintain the consistency when the formula is typed lines. We introduce iHeartLA, a language with similar design to closely mimic a conventionally written linear algebra, while storing an unambiguous compilable interpretation. iHeartLA allows users to write a linear algebra in text form and compile the same source into LaTeX, C++ with Eigen, NumPy, SciPy, and MATLAB. This difference for inputting linear algebra not to consider the predictability of the expressions. Existing programming languages can be unambiguously compiled, but use a syntax quite unlike a conventional mathematical notation coder, while readable cannot be compiled or validated. iHeartLA combines the conventional syntax with unambiguous execution. Motivate our decisions and inform our choice of features beyond our core operations. We analyzed all numbered equations and some unnumbered equations from all technical papers published at the SIGGRAPH 2019. We take an empirical approach to language design and categorized all 1,987 equations. Here is the overview of them. Although when programming, we are encouraged to use long and descriptive variable names, it's almost unheard of in conventionally written maps. Single variables prevent ambiguity during multiplication, which is implied by juxtaposing or placing two variables side by side. Unlike in traditional programming languages, single-letter variables in math have decorations like you would see with Unicode. iHeartLA adopts these ideas to look and feel like a conventionally written math. We encourage single letter variable names, which allows for unambiguous multiplication by supposition and a convenient syntax for accessing matrix elements. Unicode allows for a large number of expressive variable names, including text decorations, many editors, including our own convenient Unicode substitutions, with tactics to enclose ambiguous long names. Variables cannot be redefined, and the compatible matrix and vector dimensions are statically checked at compile. Bahada is for spaces. Matrices can be formatted with 2D elements separated by spaces and new lines. In the left example, A and K are both scalars. It defines L as a normal 2x2 matrix, while the right example is a block matrix. It has matrices with known dimensions in the counter diagonal, and it has identity matrix and zero in the diagonal. Zero here will be lifted to a zero matrix, and the dimensions of the identity matrix and the zero matrix can both be inferred, which together defines the L matrix with known dimensions. Here are examples for the element-wise definition. In the left example, the dimension of L is the same as matrix M. The right example defines the sparse matrix and requires a type decoration. Since the elements of L are defined conditionally, the dimensions of L cannot be determined since there may be additional zeros to the right or below the elements of E. Here are examples of summations, which sometimes have implicit index ranges, are nested, or are part of larger expressions. Note that the summation operation does not often enclose its summand with parentheses. There is some ambiguity in conventional written math on the following example. It has two interpretations. This ambiguity grows in complexity if there are additional terms also involving summation, such as these examples. For guidance, we also took an empirical approach. We examined 10 complex summation formulas found in SIGGRAPH 2019. Of these, 9 were interpreted correctly with conservative summation. The summation operating at A is conservative rather than greedy. It only sums the first term to its right, not additional terms separated by addition or subtraction. Summation in A takes its bounds from the use of the index in the summand. In this linear blend scaling example, W is a sequence of scalars and T is a sequence of matrices. They have the same size. AHADA also supports functions, various norms, basic minimization, and basic integration. We evaluated AHADA on a variety of examples from different papers, books, and online courses. For each example, we chose the original formula, AHADA implementation, output code for Eigen, NumPy, MATLAB, LaTeX, and the rendered LaTeX output. Did the same evaluation on all the examples here. To simulate real-world AHADA usage, we collected a set of existing code bases and replaced the functions in them with AHADA implementations. Now let's implement a formula from this paper, instant field aligned meshes. The formula is in the end of the paper. It is the solution of an optimization problem. We will calculate the Q subscript ij here. We already have the corresponding code framework, and we are implementing the midpoint function. The four parameters in the function correspond to V subscript ij and N subscript ij here. You can open the editor from the website and type the formula directly. The editor has the conversions for Unicode symbols, so the lambda Unicode subscript ij can be typed directly. We compile the source code and copy the output C++ code snippet to the midpoint function. After building the project, we will get an executable file. we can open the application and load a new mesh file. After clicking the two solve buttons, it will call the function and generate the final results. We also took a statistical estimate of applicability, which is a fresh philosophy for programming language design, and a user study for AHLA-I. Please refer to our paper for more details. There are some example equations that cannot be directly implemented in AHLA-I. For example, there are unsupported operators, multiple conditions, derivations, derivatives, also unsupported optimizations, and others like integrals with implied domains. In future, we also plan to support more language features, add new output languages, analyze and support more fields. We imagine the future of the paper as a literary environment where formulas can be compiled to a library and also improve readability. Some related work, such as Scholify, is a proof of concept for an enhanced reading environment. A future AHLA-I can feed this system. In conclusion, AHLA-I has the potential to greatly benefit the scientific ecosystem, from researchers and practitioners to students and teachers. AHLA-I makes it easy to try new ideas, since it automates the tedious and error-prone step of translating a mathematical idea into a compilable code. AHLA-I may reduce the translation loss as ideas move from researchers to readers to implementers. Imagine a graduate student describes their implementation to a co-author who writes it in LaTeX, introducing an error. Then someone else reads the paper and implements it incorrectly. Thanks for listening. Please try our language. I'd like to take questions later.
Thank you, Yong, for the really fantastic talk. And I had just tried the web demo yesterday. It's really good. I encourage you all to give it a try. So as usual, we will proceed to the talk about Headliner and have a joint Q&A near the end. So now it's my great, great honor to introduce our Headliner, Professor Richard Zhang. So he is a professor who does not need an introduction, but we still have one. So he's a professor at Simon Fraser University, working on computer graphics and geometric learning. His research spans across a wide range of topics in geometry processing, such as his classic work on spectral method and fabrication, and also a lot of his groundbreaking work in the field of geometric learning. So he's also an influential educator where so many leading researchers I personally admire were from his group. So as we can expect it, these massive contributions have made him the recipient of a million awards, such as being recognized as a distinguished professor at Simon Fraser. So I was planning to also talk about some of important work from his group, but it will definitely take more than an hour to do that. So let's not waste too much of his time and join me to have a big welcome to our Headliner, Professor Zhang.
Thank you very much for the introduction, Derek. Let me share my screen. Let me share again because I need to click share sound. Oh, it's all good. So that's the one. Okay, so let me talk about from pyramidality to monotonicity, several interesting, I think, new decomposition and packing problems related to fabrication and planning. So I'm actually going to start by talking about something else. So I want to ask you guys, what is your favorite bounding volume? So this is a page from Wikipedia. And it's a pretty long list of all the bounding volumes that you have encountered maybe in your work. So my favorite is actually the convex hull. Now for the use of bounding volumes, we often try to find whether a point is inside or outside the classical collision detection tests. And of course, we know that the fastest the point in convex polygon test is log n time. Now, I want you to think about another, maybe a new kind of bounding volume. So of course, everyone knows about height field. So I'm referring to height field, right? So we know about height field, but I'm not sure whether people have thought about height field as being a bounding volume. So in the context of computing whether a point is inside or outside of a height field, if this height field is represented by storing the height values, then it really only takes constant time to test whether something is inside or outside. So the first part of my talk is going to be about this kind of shapes. I actually call them pyramidal shapes because they look like pyramids, and also it's a much better sounding word than height field. And another thing you may notice is that if you take this tree shape, you look at decomposing the shape into convex parts, then you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But if you want to do a decomposition into pyramidal shapes, these height fields, there are only two parts. So I have this feeling that these pyramidal shapes are more complex than convex shapes, maybe in general. And correspondingly, if you do decomposition, there is a chance of getting less number of parts if it's a pyramidal decomposition. So of course, pyramidal shapes would have a connection to 3D printing. Just a little quick primer here. So the most popular 3D printing mechanism is so-called FDM. You can think of this as squeezing toothpaste layer by layer, and they're gonna build one on top of another. And if you wanna print this tree-like shape, this is a Christmas tree, then it has this overhangs. Let me actually turn on my pen tool. Right, so you have these, overhangs over here. And then in order to print this bottom up, you have to have this support material. And this support material is actually waste because you have to get rid of it after you finish printing. Now, if you have a shape that is pyramidal, a height field, then obviously there will be no support waste. And without having to print the waste, it's also saving print time. So that's one criteria for FDM. Minimizing the total printed material would be a nice thing to have for cost saving. There are also other kinds of printing mechanisms. So another very popular one is so-called powder-based printing, as you can see from this illustration. So again, layer by layer, bottom up, you push this bunch of powder to form a layer, and you have this print head here, which goes around to melt the material to solidify your shape. So for powder-based printing, another criteria which is really important is the height, the total height of the build, right? So if you lay this shape here horizontally, then there's more cost saving compared to the other orientation, which is this one. And another very important criterion for 3D printing is best utilization of the print volume, right? So if you want to print a chair model that you actually can sit on, but the print volume is limited, you have to think about a way to actually fit it in. I'll come back to this very soon. And there are other properties like structural properties. You want it to be strong, and aesthetic properties. You want a surface finish to be nice, and also want to hide the seams in case you want to print multiple parts and then try to glue them together. So these are the issues that are certainly important. They've led to numerous SIGGRAPH papers, but I'm going to be focusing on the first two, cost saving and best utilization of the limited print volume. And as I mentioned in my abstract, 3D printing indeed has shed new light on some of the really classical geometric optimization problems, such as decomposition packing and space filling curves, which I'll cover a few of them in my talk. So I started working on 3D printing in 2012. I was inspired by this paper from Princeton on 3D printing a large shape. Well, it cannot fit in the print volume. So the solution was to just chop it up into smaller parts so that each part can fit inside of the print volume. So that was really interesting. What I thought then was that maybe the best way to utilize the print volume is not just to chop it, but actually try to pack them as well, pack them compactly, tightly. For example, if you were to use the powder-based printing, you can minimize the height by a tight packing. So I call that problem decompose and pack. And when I was giving this problem to my student, I told the student that you cannot just fix the primitive, saying that I want to cut it into cuboids and then do packing. So you cannot do decompose and then pack. You have to really strongly couple these two optimization problems together, and so that you can also have flexible primitives. This was one of these instances where the problem at the time seemed to be too difficult, so we actually gave up. Well, we went ahead and tried to solve an easier problem, which is to decompose the shape only, but instead of just decompose into parts where each can fit into print volume, we also want to optimize the printability of each part. Now you see why pyramidality comes in. So this was work by Regent Hu, my visiting student at the time. So this is the problem of pyramidal decomposition. The goal here is to decompose a 3D shape into a minimum number of pyramidal parts. So how hard is this problem for humans? So here's a 2D example. And you see that this is a house here, and there's a hole in the middle here. This is the hole. And the question is, you know, what's the minimum number of pyramidal parts you can get from this shape? And we actually did a user study, and these were solutions provided by smart CS grad students. In fact, none of these solutions is optimal. The optimal solution is 2. And this was the solution that we were able to find using our algorithm. And I guess it's really not that trivial. In 3D, searching the problem is much more difficult. This problem had a bit of a history. So if you think about exact pyramidal decomposition, the problem actually was provably NP-hard for 3D shapes and also for 2D polygons with holes. This was proved in 2001. But we may not actually want exact pyramidal decomposition because for a real shape, maybe you have too many parts. So we turned into an approximate version of this problem, APD, approximate pyramidal decomposition, where each part only needs to be approximately pyramidal. We can reduce the waste material, not completely eliminating it. And we still seek as few parts as possible. So this requires us to have a pyramidality measure, which is pretty easy to define. So it depends on a direction, the up direction. So when you have a base like this, and this is up direction, we can basically just measure what's the estimated support waste. So this would be the one, because you do a perpendicular projection, and then whatever is not part of the shape would be the support waste. So this pyramidality is going to be estimated over all directions, and we're going to take the direction with the least material waste relative to the projected area as the pyramidality measure. So the construction algorithm. So Ritten found that you can turn this APD problem into an exact cover problem, or ECP. So I'm going to explain the ECP just in a bit. Let me first set it up. So given a shape, we first find a block partition of the shape as follows. And I'll explain how this was done just in a bit. And then this block partition can provide a set of subsets, right? So each one of these is a subset. For example, 1, so this one here is a subset. And you can also have 1 and 2 together. So this one is also a subset, okay? So a cover consists of a set of candidate pyramidal parts, and each part is a subset of these set of blocks, right? So, and then the ECP, the exact cover problem, tries to find an exact cover, right? Taking a subset of these things so they can exactly cover. So that's exactly a decomposition, right? So ECP is an NP complete problem. The decision version of the problem is NP complete. And fortunately, there are good algorithms. The famous algorithm here is called the algorithm X, developed by Donald Knuth. And this algorithm can efficiently enumerate all solutions to ECP. And then you can actually just look at the enumeration and then pick the ones that you like based on some kind of criteria. And these ones here that you see are solutions computed using the algorithm X. Right, so then one thing I hadn't explained is how do you find these candidate pyramidal parts? So the idea was to progressively build larger and larger blocks, starting from the smallest primitives, which are point samples. And from point samples, we can cluster them into cells, and from cells to blocks, and then from blocks to candidate pyramidal parts. It is in this step here that we look at the pyramidality measure. Throughout the whole process, I won't have time to go into the technical details of the algorithm. I'll just mention that in these clustering steps, the key clustering criterion was to group elements that are likely to belong to large pyramidal parts, because we do want to minimize the number of pyramidal parts in the decomposition. So here are some results on 3D shapes, like you see on the right. So these results were computed based on considering both material saving and part counts. You see the part the number of parts here is relatively small. So one thing I wanted to notice is you look at each shape, you think about how many parts you would get with an approximate convex decomposition. So my feeling is that you tend to get more convex parts compared to pyramidal parts. You could also tune the algorithm to only focus on material saving. So this is going to result in more parts, but it's going to have more exact, closer to exact minimization of or elimination of the support waste. In particular, you again look at these three examples. On the left, you have 7 parts. This one has no support waste. On the right, you have fewer number of parts, but you do have some support waste. Now you can see why this picture here was on my page. This was one of my favorite papers. And on the right, you see that the paper was published in 2014 that SFU gives that on their Christmas card to holiday greeting cards to everyone at SFU. And at the bottom, you see some examples. When you print these parts, so this one has 3 parts, 1, 2, and 3, you glue them together. And on the right, you see if you were to print it using conventional 3D printing as a single part, then you have the support waste here. The same thing goes with this horse model. Okay, well, it's almost December. We think about holidays. It wouldn't be a holiday without thinking about chocolates. So it's clear that pyramidal shapes are all moldable, right? Because you can actually make molds and then you put in chocolate, you can actually take it out, right? Without breaking the chocolate. But if you relax this to approximate pyramidality, then it may lead to breakage. So an interesting problem we thought about at the time, as we haven't got a time to actually get to it, was this called, I call it a pyramidalization, right? So if you take a shape that's something you want to make into chocolate, you want to actually use molds, then if it doesn't admit a small exact pyramidal decomposition, then you can try to see how to slightly modify the shape so that it would admit an exact pyramidal decomposition with a few parts. I think that's an interesting problem. Okay, so as I mentioned, we gave up on this decomposition pack for a little bit, focused on a pyramidal decomposition, which turned out to be a very interesting and satisfying pursuit. But we eventually wanted to go back to decompose and pack. So this thing I called Dapper. So if you recall, this decompose and pack solution can best utilize the print volume. And correspondingly, it will save print time and material. This is especially attractive for powder-based 3D printing. So when you do a packing like this, you don't have to worry about these overhangs over here. You just have to worry about minimizing the height through a tight packing. So just to make this problem exact, that problem is given a 3D shape S and the print volume V, we want to decompose S into small number of parts to be packed compactly into V. And we could do this either for powder-based printing where this height minimization is a criteria, but if you want to do FDM, you can have a different criteria for optimizing this for FDM. The key from a computational perspective is that we must solve D and P together instead of decomposing to some kind of well-known set of primitives and then pack them. So we don't want to have the decoupling. So we realized that in order to solve that, we have to make concessions. We have to make the problem more tractable. So there are various things we have to do to reduce the problem complexity. The first one was to reduce the geometric primitives. We cannot allow arbitrary primitives because it's just too difficult. The search space is going to be too large. And also arbitrary primitives are difficult to pack. We also need to restrict the direction of the cut and packing. And finally, we had to settle for heuristics and suboptimality. So guess what? This first pursuit of pyramidal decomposition turned out to be very, very valuable. What we chose in terms of what primitives to use for the DAP problem, the answer was pyramidal parts. Okay. So one thing we noted was that, of course, we knew that pyramidal shapes were very friendly to 3D printing. They're also packing friendly, right? Because there's really only one side you have to worry about when you pack, right? Because the other side here, the base here, they're flat. Right. You have to worry about this. I call it the teeth size. You have to kind of, you know, make sure that they they match up. There's no inner pockets here to worry about for the pyramidal parts. Another thing that was interesting, because we're doing these cuts, right? We're doing decomposition. And if you restrict the cuts to be axis aligned, then the pyramidal shapes are closed. There's a closure property, right? Because if you do this axial cuts, then you still get pyramidal parts, which is highly desirable in the context of decomposition. And the further search reduction. So we only consider pyramidal polycubes, right? Instead of having arbitrary geometric shapes while maintaining pyramidality. So we voxelize the input shapes. We only search for axial cuts, three directions in 3D, and we only allow 90 degree rotations. Can you see where this is going? Well, this is basically like playing 3D Tetris, right? You have these polycubes, you can rotate them, you can try to pack them together, right? So that was kind of really, really fun for us in the project. So here is an overview of the algorithm. So we're gonna start by an initial decomposition into pyramidal parts for a given 3D shape. And then we're going to bound these shapes using tight pyramidal polycubes. And then the middle part is where the meat of the algorithm goes. It's also the most expensive part. So it's a highly complex computational problem. So we relied on a priority-driven beam search. It's bounded just to reduce the complexity. There are two operations to choose from. One is just to pack the pyramidal polycube, and the other one is cut and pack. So you have to decide where to cut and then to pack one of the pieces. So it's essentially global optimization with some mechanisms to reduce the search cost. You can do some pruning if you had a criteria for whether it's for powder-based printing or it's for FDM printing. You can prune the search tree if it's not so promising. And we'll also bound the search width. And at the end, if you reach a solution, which was a solution for a pyramidal polycube, you can do a final step, which is to do local refinement, just to lower things down, just to reduce the gap, to get a more compact final solution. So here I'm going to play a video just to give you a quick illustration. And this video has voiceover, but the voiceover might be a bit low. I'm going to stop talking and play the video.
DAPA starts by decomposing it into pyramidal parts of typically a small number. Here, just three. Then the parts are voxelized, and the parts are packed into the container. We show here the sequence that leads to the best solution. It is one branch in a beam search. Note that some pieces are cut on the fly, and yet all pieces are pyramidal, which facilitate their docking. We started with three pieces, and the final solution consists of five pieces. Now we show a similar sequence of a 3D model. Given a 3D shape, here a chair, and its initial decomposition, the parts are voxelized and packed in the container while introducing axial cuts. Again, here we show just the winner sequence in the beam search.
There you go. Well, I thought it was really, really fun. It was actually exactly like playing 3D Tetris. All right, so that was additive manufacturing, 3D printing, where you build things layer by layer. And we also actually came across a very interesting problem for subtractive manufacturing. Just again, let me just set up the scene for you. So the primary way to do subtractive manufacturing is actually taking away material, right? It's CNC machining, right? CNC here stands for computer numerical control. And you start with an initial material stock here, like this big cube. And you have a target shape here. The target here is the sphere that's inside. And the rest is called the residual volume, right? The process is to carve off the residual volume using a cutter. So this is the cutter. And you're gonna reach the target shape. And the most common CNC machine performs this three-axis machining. This cutter can go up and down and then into the X and Y direction to produce the cut. So there are some key considerations for CNC machining that that do not apply to 3D printing. So I actually think CNC machining is a more complicated process that has a lot of steps and at the same time introduce some really interesting and unique problems. So one thing about just CNC machining is you have to set up, you have to determine an orientation for the for your shape, the carving direction for your cutter, and then you have to fasten it, right? It's got the, you have to use some certain fixtures to fix it, right? So that's a setup for each direction is quite expensive, takes effort and, you know, takes skill. So one of the considerations for CNC machining is to minimize the number of setups. Okay? So this is synonymous to minimize the number of carving directions. And the other thing that you can see from this example here is that the carving direction actually matter, right? So you may get the same result, but on the right, your carving process is going to finish much earlier. On the left, you have to have multiple paths because of the obstructions that the cutter has to go through. It's going to have multiple paths. It has to stop and go, stop and go, stop and go. So an interesting geometrical question was then, you know, what shapes are ideal, right? Just like, you know, pyramidal shapes are ideal for FDM printing, not for this kind of carving. If you have a given carving direction, so what volume would allow you to carve, to save carving time? So this is really related to continuity. If you can continuously carve without any stop and go, then that would be desirable. So when I ask questions, what volume would allow a continuous carving? So there are some well-known geometric properties. One is the visibility here. You see on the left, you have something which is visible. On the right, it doesn't. It's not visible. And another related, this is the monotonicity that I had in my title of my talk. So a shape is monotone respect to a direction. So here's a direction over here. Is if each line perpendicular to the direction cuts the shape at most two points. So this would be monotone, and the one on the right is not monotone. It turns out it shouldn't be too hard to see that the coverability or a shape that would allow continuous carving is a combination of visibility and monotonicity. So we call this indeed coverability. And it's a new geometric property. It's not convexity, it's not pyramidality, it's not visibility alone, it is not monotonicity alone, something which is new. And this is something we desire. And another remark is there's a relation between monotonicity and pyramidality, right? So in the case of monotonicity, you need to have, this is two intersections per horizontal line here. And then for pyramidal shapes, two intersections along each direction perpendicular to the base. So there's some kind of relation between these two interesting properties. Now, coverability really led to this very new decomposition problem, which is given a target 3D shape, we know what the residual volume is, and we want to have a minimum number of setup directions and also minimize the number of coverable volumes. Right? So that was the coverable volume decomposition problem that we studied at SIGGRAPH Asia 2020 that was published at SIGGRAPH 2020. So again, given the interest of time, I wouldn't have the time to actually talk about the algorithm. If you're interested, please feel free to check out the paper. But that problem there, coverable volume decomposition, was a new one, and we found a heuristic solution to it. Right, now let me switch gear again to talk about, instead of asking the question, what to fabricate, I call that fabrication-aware design, especially designing of the input. You want to optimize the input shape, you want to 3D print, or the residual volume so that you have efficiency, saving cost, minimizing height. The operations you may want to perform are things like decomposition and packing. And in this case, the process is hollowing the shape, right? So you don't have to print the whole solid. Now, I want to switch gear from that kind of a design problem into how to fabricate. Suppose you know what you want to print, or you know what you need to carve off. The question is, how do you do that efficiently? And then this is related to a problem called two-path planning. Right. So if you think about FDM printing, right, for each layer, you have this print head that's going to go around squeezing your toothpaste, right? and you're going to fill the space that has to be printed, right? So the two-path fill problem really is a problem of space filling curve. So here you see a famous one, which is the Hilbert curve. A Hilbert curve is really not a desirable two-fill pattern for 3D printing. But the choice of the two-path would affect print time and also infill quality and surface quality. The most popular two-path fill pattern is the zigzag. As you can see, this is the pattern. And now here is one layer. It's one that has a hole inside. Now, if you do zigzag, you can see how many disconnect patches there has to be, right? And disconnectings are actually not desirable, as I'll explain. So also because of you have to stop, right? You kind of stop squeezing your toothpaste and you have to find another starting point to squeeze out your toothpaste again. You have this overfill problem, right? And usually when I keep using this example of squeezing toothpaste, the very first squeeze is usually not a perfect one, right? In between is good and uniform. And the first one is the last one usually are not so good. You could have underfill and overfill. And as a result of that, you have this rough boundaries, right? Overfill is something to be avoided. So indeed for zigzag, there is a lot of discontinuity. And when you have to do a turn off and turn on, you have to go through a void path, which can be considered as a waste of time. And also you have a bad fill quality. So what's desirable is you have a continuity, right? Just like continuous carving, you have continuous infill, right? Using a two path. And another problem is these sharp turns, right? For zigzag, a lot of sharp turns, because you're gonna turn all the way to the other direction at the end of your path, right? And you have this not only jagged surface boundary, and also because it is print head is mechanical, right? So near a sharp turn, it cannot be too fast. You have to deaccelerate and then you accelerate again. So these are all the result of having these sharp turns. So it's desirable then to minimize the number of sharp turns to have low curvature two paths. So there are some solutions that were proposed beyond zigzag. So one of them is so-called ISO contours or contour parallel paths. So as you can see from this example, essentially you do this distance, Euclidean distance transform. It has less sharp turns compared to zigzag and also conforms better to boundary. But these are all disconnected, right? And you also have this disconnected pockets if you have a somewhat complex shape. So again, you have a lot of discontinuity. Now the next solution is to turn these contour parallel paths into spirals. Okay, so here is the director spiral. I think it's called Archimedes spiral. So it shares the nice properties as the contour parallel paths. You can just do some kind of offsetting. You can turn a iso contours into a spiral. So indeed, spiral was a good choice for infills, for two-path planning. So here, for somewhat complex layers, you have these separate spirals, and they are, again, disconnected. So is it possible to connect the spirals? Well, for the regular spiral, you start outside, you have to end up inside, or the other way around. You could actually connect two of them, but not more than two, right? So because you're going to be stuck inside. So it's in general not possible to connect all of the spirals on the one on the left. So the question that we posed was, is it always possible to fill a connected 2D region using a globally continuous path with low number of sharp turns? Okay, so what we found that was actually fascinating to me personally was there was another spiral I actually didn't know. I didn't know about this spiral before this work that we did back in 2016. And that was the Fermat spirals. Indeed, it was attributed to the famous mathematician. As you can see, this Fermat spiral goes outside and in, and then it goes back. It's actually two branches of the Fermat spiral. So these Fermat spirals share very much the same nice property compared to spirals and contour parallel paths, conform to surface boundary better, less sharp turns than zigzag, and continuity for simple shapes. And there are some additional interesting properties that are desirable. So one thing is that it can start and end both on the boundary. And furthermore, you can freely place the start endpoints to make them next to each other, right? This turned out to be a good and useful property when you try to connect all the spirals together. Okay. So you can see that now we have three pockets, and I put all of these start endpoints together, and there'll be some easy way to connect all of them into a globally continuous path. So these are the key steps to come up with this, what we call connected Fermat spirals over a continuous 2D region is guaranteed to be globally continuous. We first apply Euclidean distance transform to get this isocontours. It may have disconnected pockets. And then for each pocket, we're going to turn that into a Fermat spiral. And then we're going to move things around so that the start endpoints are next to each other. And then we have this way, right? I'm not going to cover this in this talk and the details in the SIGGRAPH paper to connect all of them into a single continuous path. And then you can then apply some kind of a Foucault smoothing. So these are some really beautiful patterns. As you can see, it can also feel a very complicated pattern. The cat on this is one layer of a kitten model, where you have these hollow parts, right? So, and this is the resulting connected Fermat spiral. And here is a video. I hope I turned the sound off that you can see this Fermat spiral in action. So I've been watching this video, like, I don't know how many times, I sometimes just mesmerizing to follow these interesting patterns. And you can quickly see what 2D region it is trying to cover. Yeah, the music would have made this sound much cooler. So now it's going to a pocket, go inward and then outward. And then going into another pocket. Yeah, the whole thing is continuous. Okay, so I will stop it here. And after a year or two, I think, we use the same idea, this Fermat spirals, and going from 3D printing, which is to fill a flat layer, to carving, right? So this Fermat spiral could be generalized into carving a 3D volume, the residual volume. So here is a video. This one, I have sound. It's just mechanical sound. That's the cutter there, the same kitten. There you go. Okay, so okay, so here we go, sorry. So there were some interesting thoughts after this Fermat spiral. Would it be only useful for two path planning? So after some conversation, some people told me to look into drip irrigation, just something completely different from a two path planning. So on the right, you see an image showing that the spiral path actually could be considered as desirable for arranging the paths of these, you know, drip pipes. Right. So this is different from using the sprinklers to water your plant, to water your field, is to have this slow dripping following a path over a field. And it could be interesting to think of Fermat spiral being something which is completely continuous, no breakage, covering maybe a non-trivial region, possibly with holes. Just to recap what I have mentioned so far on this, I would think interesting new problems related to fabrication. So I started with the pyramidal decomposition that is given a 3D shape, try to come up with a small number of parts, each of which is approximately pyramidal. We solved that using ECP, exact cover problem. And then a problem that we initially gave up, which was the difficult to decompose and pack, but we got better intuition of how to make the problem tractable, learning from the pyramidal decomposition, which turned out into kind of playing a 3D Tetris game, but it was still a heuristic solution. And then next, going from 3D printing to subtractive manufacturing, CNC machining, and we posed a new problem called coverable volume decomposition, where coverability is a combination of visibility and another well-known geometric property, which is called monotonicity. And finally, we had this, I think it's really beautiful piece of work on Fermat spirals. By the way, the paper was featured on two media papers a few years ago. As a two-path field pattern, as a new kind of space feeding curves could be applied to infill a flat layer or to go through a volume to do carving for CNC machining. Well, actually, another just short remark was that we have been calling this work mowing, this Fermat spiral work called mowing, right? Because we first thought about there's some relevance to how do you mow a lawn. So, you know, this may be an inspiration. Next time you mow your lawn, you can, instead of following these boring patterns of just irregular spiral or a zigzag, is to follow a Fermat spiral. That will get your house noticed. Okay, so let me summarize. So we were really looking into some hard combinatorial problems. So the pyramidal decomposition for polygons with holes and also in the 3D, they are NP hard. I should also mention that monotone decomposition of polygons with holes was also proven to be NP hard. We were not really aware of attempts on trying to solve 3D versions of these problems. And also the decomposed unpacked problem was also new. Maybe it really have 3D fabrication, 3D printing to thank for, because these actually truly become real problems that we wanted to tackle. Also, this led to some new questions and new problems, right? So I thought it would be interesting to think of pyramidal shape, these height fields, as a new kind of a bounding volume, right? You can think of how do you represent it most efficiently, space and time trade-off, and how do you come with a hierarchical representation? I mentioned the pyramidalization as this problem trying to minimally modify a shape so that it would admit a small exact pyramid decomposition to maybe design modes for your chocolate. And you can also think of a similar version of the coverbilization problem, where again, try to minimally modify a shape so they would admit a small a coverable volume decomposition for the residual volume. I want to bring attention, so we have a lot of geometry people here working in computer graphics. Most of the geometry problems you've seen so far, as a popular C graph, I would say, were about 3D printing. But I believe there are more interesting, more challenging, and more varied problems in CNC machining. Rough and fine machining are different kind of problems. They actually lead to different geometry problems. And also just the fixture design, how to design these fixtures, customer made, that actually leads to some interesting geometry problems. Also cartridge design. And finally, automation of setup planning. There are also problems related to robotic vision and planning, right? Because there, you can actually try to think of designing robots to do these CNC machinings for you. If you are into the rigor and the mathematical properties of things, we are certainly very far off here. So for example, I kept calling the connected Fermat spirals as space filling curves, but they are actually not provably space filling. Right, we don't know the limit properties. We're really very far from having any kind of theoretical guarantee that it's actually space filling. It probably does the job. Does a good job in practice. And so complexity of this APD, which is approximate pyramidal decomposition, and the DAP solutions are unknown. Right, we have highly heuristic solutions, and for our solutions, we don't really have approximation bounds. The final question, I think I still have a bit time, is what about machinery? Right? I probably think 5 minutes or so. Can machine learning help solve these hard problems? So first, a disclaimer that I'm definitely not an expert on this topic. I worked on this a little bit with my colleagues. So I have a few points I think may be useful. I think the hope for neural networks, the kind of role that they can play here, is to speed up over the traditional combinatorial search. In fact, this was shown in some works that we published that they are significantly faster than the traditional combinatorial search. And it's really a time and space trade-off, right? So with network, neural networks use these ways to essentially store knowledge so that it would lead to a faster prediction. You should forget about supervision, because the whole point here, this being very difficult, the problem is that it's very difficult to come up with ground truth solutions. So two alternatives are worth exploring. One of them is reinforcement learning, and the other one is self-supervised learning. I'll give you some quick examples. And for RL, of course, you need to carefully design your environments and your rewards. And for self-supervision, two things are desirable. One is that you are able to easily create lots of data for augmentation to be able to train your self-supervised network. And the other one is when you define the laws should be defined on the intrinsic properties of the output, something you can define just on the output alone without having to compare that to the ground truth, because you don't really have ground truth to help you train your neural network. So we'll see some quick examples. The first one, this was worked by, again, the brilliant region who, we call it TapNet. So we had DAP, now this is TAP. So TAP stands for transport and pack, right? This is actually a real problem where you have these boxes, you wanna go from one configuration and you wanna pack them into boxes. You have to really plan that, you know, in which order you pick them up and do you have to rotate 90 degrees and things like that. And then compactly pack that into a target container. So because this is a sequential decision-making problem, it's really a good fit for reinforcement learning, maybe DAP as well. So the environment here, very quick, the environment was set up by these precedence graphs, which define constraints, because you cannot just take any block, right? There's some kind of a dependency that has to be transported in a particular order. And also on the target end, you also have this packing configuration, right? These two together define the environment or the state, and the rewards are given by packing efficiency and also the stability of the packing in the target container. So for more technical details of how RL works for this particular problem, you're welcome to refer to the paper. And the one thing that I was really interested in personally was whether this RL solution could be generalized to larger problem instances, because you know when you're training your reinforcement learning method, you need to fix the number of objects. You cannot just take any arbitrary number of objects. So the question is, can this be generalized when you have larger and larger problem instances? So it may be possible if you can expect that a partial environment would be a typical thing to have in your problem setup. So here, I want to show you an example where we have this method was trained for four objects. Now you have six objects. So here, A, B, C, D, E, F, six objects. So what happens here is that because the network was trained for four objects, our precedence graph is only going to have four nodes at a time. So it may start with C, B, E, and F in the precedence graph. And then the network is going to predict which block you need to transport and pack. So maybe C is gone. And then when C is gone, you have room to bring another block in here. You bring D in. So C out, D in, and finally B out and A in. So we call this a rolling scheme because actually we're rolling this blocks into the environment, right? So this is not surprising in the case of this transport and pack, because as you can see, at the start, only C, B, E, and F could be moved anyway. So A and D are blocked. Only after you've moved some blocks, they can be exposed and they can be actually put into your environment. So if this is possible, then you can train your RL on a small problem instance and that can be extended to a larger instance, but it may not always be the case for all problems. So the final example is another neural network that is trained to learn tiling, right? Which is another NP-hard problem. And the problem here uses self-supervision, I'll get to maximally tile a region with a fixed tile type, a few types of tiles. So in this case, you have two of them. They're not exactly because they're actually reflections of each other. Here we're training a graph neural network to predict tile placement. And here are some details. So it's a self-supervised learning approach. The first thing to do is to make sure you have this, you know, augmented instances to train your network. So we take these, we know the tiles, the tile types, and we use them to compute these tiling supersets to cover large regions, Okay, and then we do this random crop, come up with random polygons to crop this tile supersets so that we get these different shapes to compute these candidate tile locations. And then the graph neural network is trained to select a subset from this superset that would give you a tiling, right? And the losses here is important. The losses are you want to ensure maximal coverage, you want to minimize the holes, you also want to minimize overlaps. Do you know that these three criteria are intrinsic to the tiling? It is not something you have to compare against the ground truth. So with these things set up, it is possible to use a self-supervised learning framework to do tiling. We call it the tiling GNN. Okay, so that's it. I hope I didn't go over time. So here are the references, and I also certainly want to thank all the students and collaborators for their fantastic effort. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Richard, for this is a really inspiring talk. And we'll now start our joint Q&A session. And because we are kind of already like 5 minutes late, so I will try to be quick about the questions. But if you still have other questions like after this Q&A, please feel free to post them in the Discord channel. So first, let's give Richard like a water break, and then we will start with a question for Yong. So we are wondering about the reverse path. Like, is it possible to actually turn like a code implementation into mathematical equations?
Yeah, that's an awesome idea as well. And I believe there are more challenges than AHRAE. For example, and there are some similarities here. For example, when we try to use AHRAE, some math equations cannot be converted to code, like the derivations, we may not need to implement it. And it has the same problem when in the inverse way, like some code actually doesn't have a corresponding math equation. So that would be a certain limitation here. And so that we may use the pseudocode sometime instead of the math equations to represent our ideas. And another challenge may be by using AHRAE, we can translate the math equation to different backends. But for the inverse problem, maybe even if you have an implementation for C++, maybe it's not easy to transfer that to apply to Python or MATLAB, other languages as the input. But I believe that may be possible for a certain small set of algorithms. Maybe, for example, instead of analyzing the text directly, I think we may rely on the compilers. Like if we are going to take the C++ code as input, we may not to analyze the text. Instead, we may rely on the C++ compiler and analyze the abstract syntax tree. And based on that, maybe that's a pre-processing step to simplify the whole process. But I still believe it's possible for some certain algorithm. Yeah.
Cool. Thank you for this really detailed answer. I look forward to seeing you having the solutions like after a few years. Okay. So now next questions for Richard. So the questions are the This is a follow-up question on your summary slide about the Fermat spirals, is that you said this is not provably to be like space filling, but we're just curious, like whether this Fermat spiral, which is very amazing, like is this type of spiral optimal in some sense? Is it, for example, can we say it is a minimizer or some energies or something, or you're using this simply because it is convenient that we can potentially place the endpoints nearby each other?
So I will probably say probably no. If it's a single piece, so by the way, there's a Wikipedia page pretty much with all the math equations you can read. I'm pretty sure you will be able to prove certain mathematical properties. But then when you disconnect the Fermat spiral, it's just not very rigorous, right? Because we have this heuristic way of, you know, placing where the starting endpoints are, and we can connect them. So we can guarantee continuity, but then you're gonna lose the rigor of a mathematical expression for these resulting connect from our spirals. I don't know what's best, but there's always the hope you can prove some nice properties about them, right? Maybe not for graphics, but for some other, some other purpose. So yeah, to answer your question, I don't know. I don't think you can easily prove mathematical properties, but we can always sort of improve. For example, there are still some inadequacies in terms of the turns, the fact that there are still gaps is our current algorithm, right? So there may be some local optimization schemes to actually make sure at least it's uniformly spaced. That is something that could be worked on.
Thank you for this detailed answer. And next question is for Yang. And so basically, in a lot of like papers, like for example, different people when write the papers, they will use different notations for their equations. And for example, when they write papers, they may also have some hidden details that are not listed as the equation, but written down in the text format. Like when we use like hard LA to implement some papers, have you encountered any problems related to this?
Yeah. A similar problem, maybe different equations. A same equation may have different representations,
right?
Like a summation, right? If you specify the bounds of the summation, the upper bound and the lower bound, we have different ways to specify that. And when using ahead, actually we choose like a normalized way, so the latex output would be the same. Yeah.
Okay, understood. Okay, and so sorry for the time method. Now is the last question for Richard. Is that have you also considered to optimize for the assembly process? Basically, right now you show a lot of great example where we can optimize for the packing or for like printability, but is it also possible to optimize for the decomposition so that we can easily like assemble these pieces together, like lock them with each other like a Lego so that we don't need to, for example, glue them together?
Yeah, I think that's a great question, right? So I haven't thought about it, but this is where I'm hoping the talk would really inspire many new problems, right? So there have been, you know, machine learning algorithm learning to assemble, right? Learning to find out this procedural modeling, construction sequences. These are certainly worth looking to. For something, if you have, you know, potential interlocking, right? So I would say my colleague, Philip Fu is the expert on that. I will probably raise this question with him and maybe we'll come up with a paper. Yeah, so certainly finding this optimal way to assemble things is definitely a problem worth pursuing.
Thank you. Okay, so now that's the end of our Q&A. So I know there are still a lot of questions left, and please feel free to ask them in the Discord channel. We will guide our speakers to them to answer those questions. So now thank you everyone for joining this colloquium. And we also want to thank the artist Dorothy Leon for making the great poster for this week, and see you all next week.